Hi, I'm going to go through some questions about my artwork. Got a list of questions here. I'll just go through them in order. We'll see how that goes. I'll put that on the ground, so I'm not holding it. Okay, number one, a little bit about myself, background and training. Hi, my name is Tom White. I'm a New Zealand visual artist. I've been working for several years on this series combining artificial intelligence and these large screen prints. My background is mathematics, computer science, art, graphic design, human-computer interface. So after graduating with a degree in mathematics, I went to MIT. I joined a group of students there called the MIT Media Lab Aesthetics and Computation Group, headed by John Maida. There we worked on innovative human-computer interfaces. I worked on a multi-touch interface. This was in the late 90s, before such things were common. Other things we worked on in the group were drawing systems. So we worked on early versions of software that helped people to understand the capabilities of combining interactive graphics. And those drawing systems went on to become systems that are still used today. So processing and P5JS and open frameworks all use software that I and some other students made at the lab at that time. But my interest has always been in finding ways to come up with new visual expressions through generative art and specifically through artificial intelligence techniques. Question number two, how you came to be interested in digital media and AI? How did I come to be interested in digital media and AI? So I have always been interested in the intersection of computation and visual arts, specifically in intelligent software. My early experiments were in the mid 90s, and at the time artificial intelligence used a lot of evolutionary computing and rule-based systems, and so I had exhibitions which were based on reading in images from a camera and then expressing those through evolutionary computing systems. Later, I did interactive exhibitions where it used rule-based systems and WordNet and other techniques at the time. But I've always been interested in the capabilities of these systems, and lately, in the last 5 to 10 years, it's been a really exciting time for this. So I've been looking mostly at computer vision systems because we really, even the people working on this, the computer scientists, are very surprised at how these things work and what they're capable of. And my focus is trying to express the capabilities of these machines, which sometimes are different than our own capabilities visually through artwork. Next question, do you feel making this is important and important work now and why? So do I feel like this is important work now and why? Yes, this is important work now, and I think this is an exciting time for this work because right now the capabilities of the machine are changing so fast. So having worked on this for 25 years, I can tell you that this was kind of a slow and steady slog to figure these systems out, but suddenly in the last 5 or 10 years, it's just advance after advance after advance. So especially in computer vision, what seemed impossible 5 to 10 years ago is commonplace today and is even in our phones. So this is a really exciting time because the technology is kind of moving ahead of our imagination. And so I think it's interesting that artists and other people reacting to this and coming up with ways of capturing and exploring the space. And I think that looking back on it, we'll see this as kind of a punctuated equilibrium, a moment of great change in what the technology can do. What do you think people will say about what is being created 50 or 100 years from now? So 50 or 100 years now, if people look back at the art that's being created today, I think they'll probably look at this era as transformational, similar to 50 or 100 years ago from now, it was photography. So and photography really changed how we relate to the world, but it also changed the role of the artist, because before, one of the most important skills for an artist was capturing reality and understanding techniques of representing the world faithfully. But suddenly we had a machine that could do that for us. And so the role of the artist at that time was in flux, and there was a lot of experimentation how to use photography. People thought photography wasn't a form of art, but I think we saw that not only did visual art change, but photography kind of matured in its own right. I think 50 or 100 years from now, we'll probably be saying the same thing about generative art, specifically generative art that uses these artificial intelligence techniques, where people will see that this was kind of that transformational time, and we'll be establishing new ways of expressing ourselves using these tools that we have available to us now. What do you think people I just did that one. Who or what inspires you and how that manifests in your work? Who or what inspires me and how it manifests work? Great question. So there's some recent inspirations, and then there's some further back. So recently, in recent history, artificial intelligence techniques specifically, I'm influenced by Harold Cohen. He was a visual artist in the 70s, 80s, 90s, and into the 2000s that worked with artificial intelligence and a painting system to get the computer to be able to represent different types of scenes. Now, who's interested specifically in how images themselves have meaning and how they convey information? And I see myself kind of in that same vein, but taking those techniques from, you know, what was being done in the 70s and 80s was kind of more rule-based systems, which was the state of the art of artificial intelligence at the time. But now that has the goalposts have moved, and now we can do so much more with vision systems than we ever imagined then. But not only that work, there's also Carl Sims worked a lot in the 80s and 90s and continues to do work combining evolutionary computing with visual systems. Maya Kruger was instrumental kind of in me understanding art, especially interactive art, which I did a lot of interactive art for many years. But if you go back further, further than the computational era, some of my influences are in pop art. So Andy Warhol and art of that era, I find it's a good medium and a good vocabulary for what I'm trying to say. Maybe it's not the same message, but I think it's a good set of constraints. And going even further back, one big influence of my work I see is Stuart Davis. So Stuart Davis is an artist that was trying to force himself to see the world in new ways, especially what one of his seminal works was the Egg Beater series. So there he took common everyday objects and he went into a studio and he looked at them day after day, month after month, and until he could represent them and capture them on canvas in a new and different way. I see myself as doing a lot of the same things, but instead of sort of being alone in my studio and staring at things intently, I'm using the computer as part of my process and trying to, through the eyes of the computer, see these objects in new ways. So I give photos of objects to the computer, they come back through the system, and I kind of get new insight in how the computer sees those objects and in turn reflect that in my artwork. Anything else you might want viewers to know or think about when looking at my work? So yeah, my work is meant to be appreciated on many levels. So hopefully it's meant to be something that appears and has the guise of a traditional artwork. But actually it's created and all the way through with neural networks. So it's very hard. I understand how it's hard for people to discern the techniques that are behind this. I try to take the performance and the sensationalism out. So you won't see me generating things with robotics or generating things in a flashy. What I try to do is look at the systems themselves kind of at a software layer. So feeding in to the system only images of real chickens, only images here of real eyes. I get the system to sort of learn what makes an eye look different than other things, and then express that in abstract artwork. So the artwork itself, I screen print and I execute, but it's planned through the neural networks just based on real world images. At the end of the process, I also take photos of the artwork and I represent those to the neural networks, to the computer vision systems, and I ask them to evaluate them. And in the evaluations, they see these abstract works for what they were intended to represent. So for example, if you show this canvas to a Google Vision system or the vision system at Amazon, it will come back to you and say that looks like an eye, even though it's sort of abstract form. So this gives us some insight in how the computers see the world, the computers that we're creating, and sometimes it's the same as us, sometimes it's different as us, and that's kind of what I'm trying to get at in my work, is showing us the sort of inner world of the AI systems we're making and how they might see the world different than we do. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Ben Snell. I'm an artist. I work with technology quite a bit, exploring the tension between creation and automation. I oftentimes make sculptures and drawings dealing with robotics and AI in particular, but a lot of my work is very introspective and physical in nature, asking questions about ourselves, about materials, about matter. The work that I'll be showing at CADIF this year are sculptures made using artificial intelligence, and there's a lot of depth to the way in which they were made, but I'm first just going to talk a little bit about AI and what first got me interested in artificial intelligence. And I think I've been interested in it for a long time, long before I knew that it was called AI or machine learning, or these words that we use so frequently these days came into our sort of vernacular. But AI has always interested me, I think, because it suggests that there's something lying beneath the surface, the cold surface of the machine, that the machine, be the computer, the robot, the TV, the phone, isn't cold. It isn't just a piece of metal, but there's actually something rich going on underneath its surface. And AI stands as sort of a symbol of what can be happening underneath that surface. And what's most interesting about AI isn't the fact that we can create algorithms that are so advanced at pattern finding these days. What's more interesting is the questions it forces us to ask about ourselves. Because in a large sense, I feel like the proliferation of contemporary AI has made me question what it means to be human. And I think that's a really common occurrence these days when new technologies are introduced. Sometimes, in the best of cases, we are able to see them as a mirror, and we're able to see our own reflection reflected back through that mirror. Oftentimes, technologies are windows, and they're windows that we look through. But to turn windows from, to turn technologies from windows into mirrors is really what I try to get at with my work. And what I find most interesting is the people, the personality, the human aspect, not just of machines, but the computational aspect of us, to try to understand ourselves as computational beings, just as much as we try to understand machines as these sort of pseudo-human beings. Now, I think, you know, a lot of my work these days deals with AI, but it sort of does so coincidentally. I think a lot of what I'm interested at heart is, and a lot of what inspires me throughout my entire life has been the magic of something. So when I was really young, I had chemistry sets full of, you know, horrible, horrible chemicals, and I would do experiments with them because I thought it was fascinating, sort of magic, what happens when you put baking soda and vinegar together, and this little explosion happens. And there was something so magical in that act that I just couldn't wrap my head around, that no matter how hard I tried, the magic was always present. And the same thing was true for this one artist whom I really admire, James Turrell. When you go see some of his light and space works in museums or in installations outside, he so carefully crafts a percept, a sort of an experience around the act of seeing. And what you see and what the person next to you sees are oftentimes quite similar and quite magical in their nature because they're so far from reality. They seem almost impossible. And the magic of it, the magic of seeing and experiencing these things is really what inspires me. And I think that's what I try to do within my own art practice these days. And it's something I've been trying to do all my life. One of my hobbies is creating bonsai, you know, the little Japanese trees. And there's something magical about them too, because there's a shift in scale, there's a shift in perspective around what this tree is and where you're placed with respect to it. And so too do I try to change the context and the placing of people with respect to my work. So if we take the sculptures, for example, the sculptures that I make with and in concert with artificial intelligence, those sculptures, I create them as the artist, I create them to sort of force a different perspective, a sort of reconciliation or a reconsidering of what AI is, who we are, and what materiality means with respect to computation. Now, I think artists that get lost in the novelty of something and the spectacle of it lose sight of the power of what they're making to influence and inspire. And these objects that people sometimes make become more demos and sort of artifacts of their process than they do become the sort of things that should be admired for the insights and the creativity and the concept and the process that went into making them. So they sort of stand in as a byproduct and less so as the object of attention. But sort of back to the point, I think my work differs in considering the materiality of something. So when we look at my sculptures, the sculptures are made by an AI that studied classical sculpture. And the way it works is I have a computer and I train it to study classical sculpture. And over time, the computer sort of learns to distill the essence of sculpture into its most basic forms. And it develops a sort of a visual vocabulary of shapes, shapes that it can use to build new, more complex shapes from. So in the same way, we might look at a dictionary when we're young and find words to create sentences with that we can piece together to have more complex meanings, so too can the algorithm, the computer that I work with, take these shapes as building blocks and build up new, more interesting, more exciting, complex shapes and forms. Now, when the computer's done studying, I ask it to close its eyes, so to speak, and to dream of or improvise something new, something that's never been seen before. And what it makes is inspired by the classics. It's not an average of everything it sees. It's somewhere between an interpolation and extrapolation. It's an improvisation or a dream. And I think those words come close to describing what it is. And it's still something that we can continue to better our understanding of in time. But for now, I liken it to a dream or an improvisation. That dream that it makes, that shape, lives at first just in the computer's mind. And at that moment, it is still just an artifact. It's an arbitrary 3D artifact that lives within it. But what I do then is I take that computer, I turn it off, I grind it into dust, and I cast it into that shape it dreamt of. So think about it. The sculpture then is not only the dream of the machine, but it's actually the machine itself. Because when you look closely at it, you'll see all these little bits of copper and silicon and plastic and PCB, the literal bits of the computer that made it. And in that sense, these sculptures, they embody the essence, the sort of character, the aura of the machines that made them. They harmonize the physicality and the virtuality of the machine. They really consummate the beingness and the coming to beingness of those machines. That is the magic of this, the impossibility of two things existing together simultaneously, the impossibility of product and process coming together in the same object of attention. So going back to that question of what art will look like in 100 years or what the people who live here in 100 years will think of the work that we make, I think there are a lot of historical precedents for that, say, you know, looking at photography, but what we do today isn't that novel. You know, Harold Cohen has been doing what we've been doing with AI-like systems for decades, and so too have many other people, many other artists. What we're doing isn't novel, you know. What we're doing isn't novel at the end of the day, but what we have to say about it and the questions that we ask can indeed be novel. The difference is a lot of people today don't believe that generative art or art made using algorithms is art at all. And, you know, if you look at the way the photography was treated, you know, 100 years ago, there are a lot of similarities between these two sorts of mediums. But what's interesting about this is, in time, as the devices that we use, like our phones and our computers, begin to sort of have more agency in I wouldn't say controlling our lives, but playing a part in our lives. In the same way that, say, you can set up an auto-reply when you're on vacation for your emails. In the same way that sort of boundary between us and machines begins to blur more and more, I believe we're going to be developing more of an empathy for machines and come to recognize ourselves more as computational beings. Because what we lack right now is an empathy for machines. What we lack as wetware as is an empathy for hardware. And at the heart of it, I believe these two systems are very similar. You know, I think a lot of my work posits that there is a soul to the machine, or that there is something buried beneath the surface that we can't quite understand, that there is some magic or mystery there. And until we become the machine, until we assimilate those qualities of machinery and computation, or until we come to understand what's actually happening within our mind, when the fields of computer science and neuroscience are finally bridged, only then will we really come to understand and appreciate generative art as art. You know, if there's one thing left that I have to say, it's that the work that I make, and I believe the work that I make isn't digital. You know, it's drawings and it's sculpture. It's easy to call it physical work because it's something you can hold, it's something you can touch, it's something you could lick if you wanted to. But the work that every other digital media artist or generative artist or interactive artist or whatever you want to call it, or AI artist makes, is still physical in nature. That everything we do still runs in processors that are physical. Everything we do is physical. Everything that is digital is inherently physical. See, I think that's so important, to embrace the integrity of the work that we make, the integrity of what it's made from, the matter that it's made from. To make something physical arbitrarily does no good. But to ask questions about what it is materially made from, to bring it into this life with purpose and with meaning, not to clutter landfills, but to ask important questions, that's important. That's really, really important. What does knowledge look like and feel like? What is computation to us? What do we do that's computation? You know, taking a recipe, making sourdough bread these days, how you make it, that's an algorithm. You know, so go one step further, and what does that mean about computation? What is computation today? Because everyone does it, and everyone thinks it, and everyone is computation. But what is that? What is that in our physical spaces? Coming back to where we live, who we are, how we feel, and what we're made of. You know, we are still just bags of flesh and water, and we still are physical beings at heart. I think that's why I continue to make physical work, because at the end of the day, I want to live with something in physical space and in a space that's intuitive to me, a space that I can understand. I feel like more and more these days I'm living in my head, living so much in my head, and I'm not engaging as much with my surroundings and my bodies. And it's so easy in these times of a pandemic to internalize and to sort of go inside. So I just, maybe on that point, really want to drive home the importance, I believe, of work that it's physical and work that is material. So, on that note, thank you.
My name is Daniel Ambrosi. I'm the leader of a human AI hybrid art team that consists of me, two brilliant software engineers, three commercial graphic software packages, and a powerful cloud-based artificial intelligence. I think whenever you collaborate with someone or something that sees the world differently from you, it can open up new ideas and insights and approaches for you as well. And in fact, in the world of computing, there's a combination of man and machine, which is known as centaurs. There are centaur chess playing teams where a human and a powerful chess playing computer will routinely beat any other human or even any other solo chess playing computer because of that combination. And so not only is it the best of both worlds, but it's very possible in certain cases that the alien intelligence, the artificial mind, can open up human minds to new ways of seeing things, and that can lead to greater competency even from the human level. Well, my partnership with an AI has opened up a way of creating artworks that are imbued with a level of intricacy, mystery, and grace that I don't think I could achieve on my own, with my own hand, with my own imagination. It's funny because ultimately I'm the one that's driving the end results, but it really does feel, while the AI is not sentient, it feels like I'm collaborating with a partner, not merely wielding a tool. And the result of that has enabled works of art that have gone way beyond what I think I'd be able to do on my own, and which continue to surprise me. Even works from the distant past can inspire one to create new works with entirely different tools. I started out really trying to emulate what the Hudson River School painters did with brushes and paints by way of a digital camera. That level of being informed by their aesthetic, by the types of elements that they were looking for, I think lent a lot of power to the photographic scenes that I was assembling and capturing. That then formed a really powerful base to which the AI's manner of interpreting my own images could go into a whole new realm where the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. If I hadn't paid attention to those centuries of history, I think the results would have been much weaker. And I think there's always much to be learned from studying the past, even the distant past. As an emerging artist, you really want to see more of your work get out there. I have a huge body of work I've amassed over the last several years, and only a few of them have actually seen the light of day. What I'd really like to see is more of that imagery get out there, because people really enjoy it so much. There's enough validation at this point for me to feel like I know it needs to be out there, it wants to be out there, and I'm actively trying to engineer a mass jailbreak, because right now I feel like a lot of these images are stuck in a digital prison, and until they get out and are displayed very large in an immersive manner, they're not able to be fully appreciated. So in addition to printing them large, backlit displays like I've been doing, I'd love to see more work done in immersive virtual reality and in digital projection venues. I'm really excited about the possibility of displaying my work in an immersive experience in the round, i.e. a space like our tech house. And that requires collaborating with an additional group of people that have the wherewithal to edit and add music and pacing and so on. To date, all of my imagery has really been basically static 2D imagery. I think because there's so much detail and so much possibility for zooming and revealing and panning and so on, that there's many opportunities going forward to collaborate with talented folks in those realms.
I'm Jake, and I use he, him pronouns. I'm going to go straight into my first work. This work here that you can see on the screen is called ZZ Querying the Dataset. All of these faces that you are seeing right now are all images of fake faces. They've actually been invented using a neural network, a machine learning algorithm. So my practice, I'm very interested in unpacking this kind of black box that we talk about when we're talking about artificial intelligence. And the way that I'm doing that at the moment is thinking about gender and bias within these networks and using drag to try and investigate artificial intelligence. The idea of injecting queer performers into images of quite normative identities, which is what most of these algorithms have been trained on, is a way to, you know, investigate the way that these systems are being built. I showed this piece last summer at the Edinburgh Festival. It was originally commissioned by the Edinburgh Futures Institute as a 7-channel installation. It showed going down a road during the festival, projected across the side of a building. So it's part of a much bigger project that I'm working on at the moment, which is called the ZZ Project. The name ZZ comes from the non-binary Z pronoun, as well as a machine learning term, which is the Z vector. And it's also apparently the French for Willy, which is coincidental. The reason that I'm using drag is because it's a fun performance form in the first instance, but it's also a way of challenging our notions around gender. So when you go to a drag performance, you're seeing a drag king or a drag queen, and they are very much challenging and questioning our preconceived notions of what gender means. So this kind of fluidity between identity and way of subverting our normative notions is something that I kind of wanted to bring into artificial intelligence, because I don't think that conversation is happening, or it needs to happen more anyway. So the next stage of this project, which I'll preview at the end of my talk, is looking more at deepfake technology and performance forms. So I'm working with a well-known London drag queen and the Edinburgh Futures Institute on that project. So next, I'd like to explain a little bit about the sorts of processes and systems that I'm using. So I feel as an artist, it's quite important for me to be able to explain these processes, to demystify them, and to bring these conversations to a wider audience. So basically what we mean when we talk about artificial intelligence. So there are two concepts I want to speak about which really struck me as an artist on a conceptual level. The first concept is this idea of a latent space. So let's say that a system has been trained to recognize people's faces, right? A facial recognition system, which is used in the street, used for predictive policing. There are lots of political implications of what these systems do. Everything this system has learned has been trained on thousands and thousands of photographs of people's faces, a data set of a million photographs of faces. The algorithm then starts to understand all of these images, and it starts to plot them in this multidimensional space. So this space is everything that the algorithm has learnt about human faces, let's say. It's this multidimensional space, which is a bit of a complicated thing to get your head around, but like to think of it spatially, you can say, okay, every image that the algorithm has seen of faces which have large eyebrows consist down here, and all of the faces with smaller noses exist over here, or gender or race, and they start to exist in these different areas. What you can do is you can kind of move through this space and say, okay, what's this intermediary space between male and female, between gender or between race? So in a way, there is this kind of queerness that exists already in these machine learning algorithms, that this space has these in-between places which contain kind of these fluid identities. Right now, I'm just talking about images, but this concept also exists if you train a network, an AI, on sounds or on language. So the whole of the English language can be plotted in this space as well, which contains the meanings of the words we're using. A project from 2018 called T-SNE Map shows artwork from over 600 different museum collections, including the National Gallery, and it's navigating through all of these images depending on what all of these images have in common. So it might plot an artwork close to another artwork that it starts to see these similarities between. The second concept that I want to briefly talk about is how you can use AI to create fake images. So this is something that really excited me as an artist. So let's say that you've got a system like the one I was mentioning before to classify images of faces, and it's really, really good at saying, okay, that's definitely a picture of a face. So if you take that network, that neural network, and you add a second component to it, which knows nothing about faces, it's called a generator network, and that fights against the first one, which in this instance becomes a sort of discriminator. And you start basically by generating random noise, random pixel data, and the generator will get better and better and better at creating something that the classifier network that has been trained on real human faces starts to think, okay, this is a real image of a human face. And it does this through this iterative process. That's why it's machine learning. It's learning to create something. And it starts to create these synthetic fake faces that to us can look really quite realistic, and they fall in this kind of uncanny valley. I'll show you some photographs of the sorts of fake identities and faces that this network is capable of producing. All of these faces are fake. They've been constructed through this process of trying to trick the classifier that has seen millions of real faces into thinking this is another image of a real human face. As you can see, all of these faces are quite normative identities, and there's an interesting politics of the dataset behind the sorts of faces that are included in training these algorithms. And these algorithms are being used by police and by governments. So the dataset that I'm using here is called FFHQ. There's also Celebe, there's a couple of datasets, and they're generally gathered by American white male data scientists, and it reflects the biases that those people have when they are collecting the data. So what I wanted to do is inject it with 1,000 or so images of drag performers, drag kings, drag queens, gender fluidity, and what happens is the network shifts, the weights in the neural network shift to a queerer space. So these are the sorts of images you get after injecting it with drag images. So you can see they've kind of all shifted into these stranger fluid identities, kind of representing this otherness that isn't contained in the algorithm to start with. So in a way, using drag here to challenge these biases which those generative systems tend to reinforce. Another work of mine that also uses these techniques was to create images of artificial marsh birds. And these marsh birds I took out into the Essex marshes. And all of these, again, are trained on images of birds from the marshes, but they're synthetic images, they're fake species, which are then placed. I took a kind of screen and put it out into the muds and wanted them to be having a conversation with the natural environment in the Essex marshes. So you can see a short extract of that piece here. All of the sound in this work is also produced by a neural network using AI. So they're fake sounds of birds, which it produced by listening to hours and hours of field recordings. So the next project I'd like to show comes with a content warning. It's a piece of mine called Machine Learning Porn, and it's from 2016. And basically what it's doing is it's back engineering a network which is used to remove explicit and pornographic images from Yahoo's search engine. And they released this network, and Gabriel Goh, a research scientist, found there was a way to reverse engineer this network. And I was fascinated by this, because you can open up the black box and see how a computer has been trained to understand sexual identity. And it will basically show you what the network is looking for when it's looking for explicit pornographic images of humans. I'll show a few of the images. These are stills from a video exploring this latent space of what it has learnt about human genitalia. And there's this queerness to it. It's kind of morphing between these phallic and these yonic forms that to me are kind of genderless and quite strange and bizarre. Also, what's fun about this piece is that when I wanted to share it online as an artwork, all of the main social media platforms automatically removed it because they thought it was 99.9% pornography. But of course it was generated by a machine learning algorithm similar to the one that is trying to classify it and remove it. Now, last piece I'd like to show is called ZZ and Me. It's a piece which I am working on with a research group in Edinburgh called Experiential AI, the Edinburgh Futures Institute, affiliated with the University of Edinburgh. And I'm working directly with a drag queen who's called Me. She's one of the best known drag queens in London. And what I'm doing here and trying to explore is how we can use artificial intelligence to construct a virtual body which can then be controlled. So this is basically using deepfake technology, and there's been quite a lot of talk about the darker side of deepfake to control politicians' faces. You can train it on images of Boris Johnson, and then you can make him say whatever you want. You can control his face and the skeleton, and it's created a kind of synthetic puppet for you to control. So we're interested in the politics of what data sets you're using to create these deepfakes. So we wanted to show the system something different and experiment with how machine learning can be used in a performance setting and also to satire some of the cliches around the way that we discuss artificial intelligence and the way that we often anthropomorphize AI. What we want to do eventually is to work on producing a stage show, but at the moment I'm working on a project to create a virtual platform which you can watch out for. It's going to be on zz.ai. And For the show, we'd like to work on creating a gender-neutral voice that ZZ can compare with alongside a real-life drag queen, me. Also, I like the idea of generating a sort of ultimate gay anthem pop song, which I did try. I tried training a neural network on Cher for a couple of weeks, and it actually only produced Sound of Screaming, which was an interesting one, so I'm still working on that. And I'd like to finish my talk by premiering a 30-second extract of ZZ and Me. This is ZZ on the left side of the screen and me on the right side of the screen performing together, and they're performing Me and My Shadow. So enjoy.
Me. We're closer than pages that stick
and
in a book.
My shadow.
We're closer than ripples that play in a brook.
Strolling
wherever you'll find him, you'll find me, just look. Closer than a miser or the bloodhound's Deliza, me.
We're closer than smog when it clings
and
to L.A. We're closer than Bobby is to JFK. Not a soul can bust this team in two. We stick together like glue. And when it's a sleeping time,
that's when we rock.
So thank you. That's the end of my presentation. But watch out on ZZ.ai. There's going to be more coming soon.
Hi everyone, we are Obvious, a collective of artists doing art with AI. Basically, we try to explain what is an algorithm through art, and that's why we explore the all different most known art subject in the art history with algorithms. So here is Hugo and Gauthier, my teammates, and my name is Pierre. And basically, this is where we start doing art with AI.
So we are three friends from childhood. Basically, I studied economics, Pierre studied entrepreneurship, and Hugo studied artificial intelligence. We've known each other for a very long time, and after our studies, we decided to make a creative project together.
So we're living, the three of us, in the same flat in Paris. That's why we are the three of us on the same screen today. And we work there in the suburbs of Paris.
Yeah, so basically the way we work with our algorithm is through a process of six steps. So basically what we do in our art is we are going to... So the algorithm that we use, they take as input a lot of examples of images, and then they are able to create new visuals based on these examples. And so usually what we do in our process is that we will collect lots of data, then we will work with algorithm with this data, and we will create new visual based on this data. And the final step is to create real physical pieces that we then explain and present with our artistic message through a series of 11 or 22 artworks.
So the most important thing you need to know is that we are curating what the algorithm is proposing to us. So the algorithm, as Hugo said, is generating a lot of images, and then our job as artists is to pick the right ones in order to make proper and interesting series of art. So the first series we made was with classical portraits, because everybody knows classical portraits and they can feel connected to the subject. Then we moved on to Japanese prints who have been exposed in National Museum of China, in Hermitage Museum. And then now we are really happy to release our next series about African masks.
Yeah, so there are two dimensions to our work. The first one is that the algorithms that we use, they allow the creation of new unique visuals based on a large number of examples. And in that sense, they manage to kind of replicate part of human creativity. And the second dimension is that we use those algorithms and our art to talk about artificial intelligence and to talk about the impact it has on our society. So it's a way for us to kind of showcase what's happening in research and in the implementation that is being done in our society through our work and through our art.
So in the art fair, you will be able to see artworks from the three series, and you will be able to see a preview from the African mask, because it's not yet released, but there will still be a preview at the art fair. And so you will be able to see some of the new masks that we created.
So basically, to sum up the process about this new series of African masks, we gathered a lot of images of African masks, we ran it through the algorithms, and then the algorithm generated a lot of different examples. So we had a lot of different images of African masks generated with AI. Then our choices were to get a physical pieces, not a print of those images, but to get really, really interesting pieces through collaborating with an African worker. So the Abdulaziz is from Ghana. He lives in Accra, and he created this series with the images we give him.
Yeah, so basically we work with Abdulaziz to create the physical pieces for this series. So there are a few questions that we are supposed to answer for this interview. So one of them is, what do you think people will say about your art 50 years from now? So we have been under the spotlight for an auction at Christie's in October 2018. So one of our portraits was auctioned for nearly $500,000. And so I think this really historical movement for historical moment for the movement of AI art will be one of the things that will be remembered about, obvious.
Yeah, actually the pieces have no Wikipedia page, so it really marked the history, and particularly the history of the movement we are in, AI art.
Exactly, and so it will also depend on how AI art evolves, but from what we've seen in the last years, it has been skyrocketing, and so lots and lots of artists are trying these new tools and trying to be creative with it. So we're really living an interesting era, and we can't wait to see what's going to happen in the next few years.
Yeah, actually, AI will not disappear. The society is going to be more and more digitalized, and AI is going to be more and more important. So in the future, AI will be important, and that's why AI art will not disappear. And it's not like a fashion, it's not a trend, it's something real, and who have now a very, very important place in the art field.
Yeah, and we like to compare it to photography, because we kind of received the same criticism as the first photograph when we first created our portraits. It was blurry, it was only for highly qualified engineers, it was replicable. So those criticisms, we can see that it didn't stop photography from becoming a proper art movement. So that's also one of the reasons why we believe that AI art can develop on the side of the art markets, and integrate it and become a proper art movement.
So one of the other question is,
may I add something? Yeah, I just want to add something. It's like in the next future, AI art will be something really important, because how to say that properly? No, it's okay. Sorry.
Okay, so one of the other questions that we were asked is, who inspire you? So for this, I guess we will cite three artists. So one very historical artist is Da Vinci, because his approach to mix science and art is something that's very inspirational for us. Then I guess Philippe Pompton is one of the artists that is very inspiring to us as well, because he has been really able to create a visual identity that we find fascinating. And more closer to us, I guess, in the AI art community, we feel that Refik Anadol is doing a really, really great work, and has been doing some amazing projects. So he's one of the people that inspire us the most in our community.
Exactly. Maybe we can tell you a bit more about what our message is, like through the series that we create. So for our first series of portraits, we were talking about the origins of artificial intelligence, how it was created and how it could develop in the future, in good or in bad. For our second series, we talked about the reactions that people have towards artificial intelligence and towards its arrival, and the way it integrates all of our interactions, and it optimizes our processes. And this is something that we've been through through the auction at Christie's. So we kind of lived all these reactions to our work, and we wanted to showcase it through a collection. And so for our third collection, so we decided to talk about artificial general intelligence.
Basically this concept is what we can see in science fiction, so killer robots and robots that are more intelligent than us. So basically this big idea has been very influential in the AI community, And it's the reason why there are many debates and many investments and stuff. So it's a reason of hope, and it's also people don't necessarily think that it's something that is going to happen. And so there is some kind of like cult of this concept, and we wanted to talk about this in our African Masks series.
So as Gauthier and Hugo just said, you can see that talking about AI asks a lot of questions, and doing art with AI asking even more questions. Like, for example, what are the boundaries of art? What is the relationship between an artist and his tools? What is the place of the artist in the artistic process? So all those questions are really the questions we are fascinated about, and they are like the base of the philosophy behind it. So we are just like new people who are using tools of 2020. And to do so, we create art. So this is basically what we try to do.
Exactly. So we are really happy to be part of CADAF this year. We hope you will like this first glimpse at our new series, because it will only be released in September. So we're really happy to have a first feedback on it. We hope you guys enjoy it.
Yes.
Thank you very much for your time.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.